Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to thank Ray Rothkamp for doing the PowerPoint, which you will be watching here pretty soon. And I also thank Sarah Scoble for the extra time that she's put in on this prelude. Usually she just rips through a prelude real easy, but this time it's been a little more work, I think. Thank you, Sarah. And thank you, Ray. Ray is self-quarantined again. So you'll see him in probably another week or so. Abraham, Martin, and John. Can you tell me?
extra work today, and so appreciate that. And tomorrow is Martin Luther King Day, and the annual Martin Luther King Jr. service is going to be a virtual service this year, and so the special recognition is going to Jerry Bright, and we talked about what a good friend he has been to our community, and encourage you to tune in to see the MLK service this year. As we get ready for worship, just some of the announcements on the back of your bulletin or your bulletin insert. Today is our day to ordain and install new church officers, and also following the worship service today is our annual meeting. And looking around, we are pretty close to the quorum, so if you're here, don't go until the meeting is done, because we need your presence here so that we can have a quorum to conduct the meeting. The meeting's only going to be about 5 or 10 minutes, and so please stay following the worship service if you are at all able to do that today. I'm going to be on study leave this coming week, and so John Welch will be here to preach next Sunday, so thanks in advance to John. Anybody else have announcements? I've got one from Val. Val told me that Tuesday at 4:30, there's going to be a special nationwide observance of all those who have died from COVID in this past year, and asking people to light a candle, ring a bell, a national observance of the loss that we have experienced this past year. So I encourage you to participate in that if you'd like to do that. Anyone else have announcements you need to make today?
Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty. will pray together the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin, followed by a moment of silent prayer of confession. Let us pray. Holy God, you see into each of us
and know us fully as creatures in need of your constant care. We confess that we have neither heard your word nor followed your will. We have failed our nation, neighbors, families, friends, and ourselves. Give us ears to hear your wisdom. Lead us to honesty and faith so that we may begin again with renewed strength. In Jesus' name.
God knows the hearts of those who seek forgiveness, and by grace you have been saved. In Jesus' name you are forgiven. Your sins are no more. You have been made clean. God strengthens you with freedom through the Holy Spirit. In Christ Jesus, let us sing glory to God. Our gospel lesson is found in John 1, 35-42, on page 750 in your pew Bible. Jesus' first disciples. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw the following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying and spent the day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, that is the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which, when translated, is Peter.
If you would, turn in your hymn book to page 27. This is a fairly new hymn. It does reference the scripture that we're about to hear. It references 1 Corinthians 6:20. Titled "Sacred the Body." I will be singing the first, second, and last verses of this hymn.
Cherish each person, nurture, breathe.
reading for this morning, as Warren just referenced, is from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 12 through 20. So hear God's word for us on this day. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and the stomach for food, but God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one in her body? For it is said the two become one flesh. But he who unites himself with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. May God bless to our understanding this reading from God's holy word. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Writer William Buell tells this story. He says, I went to a party one night, and one of my friends had a little bit too much to drink. And so he came to me to pose a question, and he had his glass in hand, and he was swaying before me, and he said, Mule, do you know what I would do if I believed all that Christianity bunk? And Mule confessed that no, he didn't have any idea what this guy's hypothetical piety might ask. And he said, well, here's what I would do. If I had children, I would immediately have them baptized, and then I would slit their throats ear to ear so they would go straight to heaven. That's what I'd do. I'd really rather have them go straight to heaven than suffer any heartache in life, run the risk of going to hell. So why would you do, as a loving father, do anything but send them to their immediate glory? I did mention at the beginning of the story this guy had a little bit too much to drink. Yeah. Well, before Mule had a chance to answer the question, the hostess of the party came and separated the two, saying they needed to mingle with other guests. But Mule didn't think about that question. He said the question reflects the conviction that history can have no profound consequences for the Christian. That God is engaged only in the business of redemption, and once you are saved, then God is just going to move on to the next person who hasn't yet seen the light. Is that what Christianity is all about? At the time of this letter to the Corinthians, Paul was finding out that there were some in that congregation who felt like the only thing that was important to God was salvation. What's going on with a person's soul? All things are lawful for us, they said. All things are permitted for us, they said, because God is only concerned about our souls, not what we do with our bodies. They are taking some of the words that Paul had said and they're throwing them back into his face. Because Paul had said again and again and again, you are saved by grace alone, grace alone, grace alone. And so the people thought, well, if it's grace alone, then what we do doesn't really matter. Paul had argued that in order to be righteous before God, they had to rely on grace alone. It was no longer, as had been previously believed, that you had to dot every I and cross every T and follow every single law in the book in order to be righteous before God. No, Paul said that's not true. It's grace alone, and there is a certain amount of freedom that goes with Christian living. But the people's conclusions that they were drawing from what Paul had said weren't exactly where Paul wanted them to go. Specifically, and you've got to back up a couple of chapters in 1 Corinthians to get there, but specifically, Paul was telling the people back then that the food laws that they had considered so important were maybe not quite so important, maybe not of such major concern as what they thought them to be. Food was provided for our use in our mortal lives, Paul said, but it doesn't really have any eternal significance. And so the people that heard that, some of them, began to make this leap of interpretation. And they started to apply some of what they thought the major lesson that Paul was trying to teach them. They tried to apply that lesson from food over to sex. And so they said, well, like food, we use sex just for pleasure. You know, it just involves our bodies. It doesn't involve our souls. But Paul, not surprisingly, disputes that kind of analogy. Paul argues, or he agrees in part, that yes, all things are lawful. All things are lawful, but he adds a condition. All things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. Not all things are beneficial. Not all things are profitable. C.K. Barrett states this. It doesn't follow that it is good to exercise our human freedom in an irresponsible way. In truth, only love and actions based on love are helpful. And through obedience to, and though obedience to the law is now completely discounted as a means of justification, God's law still stands, or rather has been simplified and reinforced in Christ. Our freedom is limited by our regard for others, our love for others. Our freedom is limited by our love for ourselves, by our regard for ourselves. And because we have this regard, this love for other people, then the analogy between food and sex breaks down. Sexual involvement is not merely a physical activity, like eating. It creates a new relationship with a person. It creates a bond between two people that didn't exist before. In this passage, Paul is reminding them, you know, he's not telling them anything new. Go back to Genesis 2. The two shall become one flesh. There's a difference between things that are used, food, for example, and things or more appropriately people that you tie yourself to, that you bind yourself to. Now, preachers like me need to be a little bit careful at this point not to get too preachy. Otherwise, we make it sound like sex is a thing that's always bad or dirty. Such involvement is part of God's good creation. God said, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. It's only when misused and abused that our sexuality becomes a bad thing. Paul uses this example of sexuality to illustrate what for him is a larger point. And while I don't want to dodge his teaching on sexuality, I think it's more important to spend more of our time on the larger point he had in mind. All things are permitted for me, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. Not all things are helpful. Having Christian freedom opens things up for us, but it doesn't make life any more simple. Instead of having all the laws laid out for us as to how to act in every single situation, we have to evaluate which laws are loving, how to apply those laws in loving ways, and when it is time to make an exception to one of those laws, because that's the loving thing to do. So instead of being told what God's will is in respect to our relations with other people, we have to discern what God's will is. Yeah, we are given some rules and regulations to follow, but it's up to us to decide how we apply those rules and regulations. You have to think about it. You have to decide, what's the most loving thing I can do, not only for myself, but for the other person in this situation? A lot of what was spelled out in black and white in the Old Testament is sometimes more open-ended in the New. Jesus said, "I have not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it." What did he mean by that? How does that apply? And he doesn't give us that much specific guidance. Instead, he says, here's what you really need to focus on. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, and all of your soul, and all of your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Every single thing that you do ought to be done in relation to those two commandments. Those should be the guiding principle for everything. There's a story that Morgan Kelsey tells in his book, Caring, about a man who goes to visit his mother in a nursing home. And I know people in this congregation have either been there before in the past, or maybe are there right now, or will be there at some point. Going to visit a parent in the nursing home. He writes this: "I went last Thursday to see Mother. As it is almost Christmas, I wanted to drop off a few trifling but ornately wrapped presents for her so that she would have something to look forward to in this holiday season. Mother was in her room waiting for me when I got there. She was sitting in her comfortable chair, and so we just spent the morning visiting. Talked a little bit about this, a little bit about that. There were some silences between us. Sometimes one doesn't know how to fill those awkward conversational gaps. Often we try to fill it with just little things about, you know, what did you have for lunch today? How's the weather? But after you've run out of those kinds of things to talk about, sometimes it's hard to fill those silences. I got her fur hat down from the top shelf for her so that she could wear it to church during the winter. I asked her how the food was. She said it was terrible. After a while, we went down to the dining room for lunch. Mother introduced me again to about a dozen people For the first time, although I'd met all of them several times before, he goes on with the story telling about what the visit was like and how it concluded. But that's enough of the story for right now. I don't know that there is any biblical law that says you have to go visit your mother in the nursing home. The only law that would dictate that is the law of love. And I see examples of that all around me in this church. People reaching out in love to others. Now I see the other stuff too, when perhaps we're not so loving to one another. But maybe focusing on the times when we are shows that we haven't missed the point of what Jesus Christ was all about. Life is relational. Our communion with God takes place in communion with other people. It's not this just me and God relationship. Our relationship with God takes place in the context of how we relate to everyone else. To be a Christian, you have to think about what you're doing. Have to be intentional in your relationship with others. Christianity is a thinking person's religion. That's free will and freedom. And sometimes that can feel like a heavy load to carry. But would we really want it any other way? Love one another. Your body, with your whole being, show them the love of Jesus Christ as best you can. Amen. Our hymn is number 697. We'll just sing the first four verses of Take My Life, and those who are able, we invite to stand. I'd like to invite forward Elizabeth Goad, Fritz and Helena Menning, Sherry Hesse, and Charmaine Knickerbocker to be ordained and or installed as our newest elders and deacons. We'll try to do social distancing as best we can. Beloved in Christ, in apostolic times, there were elders to whom were entrusted the oversight and leadership of the Christian churches, and concerning whom the Apostle Paul advised that they that ruled well should be counted of a double honor. Therefore, this church has from the beginning included in its government not only ministers of the word who are to preach the gospel and administer the sacraments in the name of Christ, but also ruling elders chosen by the people to represent them and share with ministers of the word in the exercise of government and discipline in the church. These ruling elders in each congregation, together with the pastor, constitute the session to which it is committed to admit members, to supervise the worship, provide for the teaching, direct the activities, and promote the spiritual interest of the church. The elders are also to represent the congregation in presbyteries, synods, and general assemblies, commissioned thereto, and it is the duty of the elders to set the example of godly conduct and character, and to assist the pastor as he may desire in his ministry to the people. Also, in the Christian churches of apostolic times, there were deacons, whose office was held in honor, and who were highly esteemed for their services to the church, in company with the elders. From early days, it was part of the duties of these office bearers to be the instruments of the church's ministry of compassion. This church, therefore, has recognized the office and work of the deacon as in accord with apostolic practice. In the course of time, new forms of work have been given to this office, and it has grown in value to the church, while to it there has always attached its ancient character as the representative of the church's purpose to follow Christ in compassion and in ministry to the needs of people. This congregation has elected Elizabeth Goad, Fritz Menning, Helena Menning as elders, and Sherry Hesse and Charmaine Knickerbocker as deacons. They have signified their willingness to serve, and we do now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, proceed to their ordination and installation. So I would ask you to answer. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you be guided by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity? Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? And this question just for the elders. Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church,
trying to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ. And this question is for the deacons. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? And Val has two questions for the congregation.
Do we, members of the church, accept Elizabeth Goh, Fritz Manning, and Lena Manning as ruling elders, and Sherry Gussie and Charmaine Knickerbocker as deacons chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the ways of Jesus Christ? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? If so, answer, we do.
During this time of COVID, the ordination service is going to take a little different shape, and it's one that we really regret doing. Normally at this time, we would have all the elders come forward for the laying on of hands and ordination prayer. We're still going to do the ordination prayer, but we're going to not have the laying on of hands this year. That's such a meaningful symbol. I would offer it to those who haven't been ordained to come back next year and experience that when we ordain and install the next group of elders and deacons. But while you mentally outstretch your hands for laying on of hands of prayer, let's bow in prayer. Set apart, O God, these thy servants to the work whereunto they have been called by the voice of the church. Grant them wisdom and grace that they may be good people full of the Holy Spirit and faith. Grant them a spirit of compassion to meet human needs. Guide them and sustain them in all their service until their work on earth is done. Amen. And you are now ruling elders and deacons of the Church of Jesus Christ, and for this congregation, whatever you do, do everything in the name of Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God through him. Amen. Thank you. I'd hug or shake hands, but this year is a weird year, and we'll get back to normal next year. There are cards back in the narthex for you to sign today. There's some sympathy cards to the families of Dick Barta and Faye Bradley, and also a congratulations card to Jack Fairbank, who is an IH Student of the Month. And then Jim Corley and Tim Haynes at the Fab Lab for the national recognition of their STEM, which is Science, Technology, and Math program for middle school girls. So those are the cards today. Call attention to the prayer card, and we've still got on our prayer card Linda Shields, but Linda is well and here, and we're glad that she is feeling better. So great to see Linda back. Any other updates on folks or anyone else we need to add? Okay, let us then come before God in prayer. Incarnate Word of Life, eternal and unchanging, you call us to discipleship and we seek to follow. Your will surpasses all earthly wisdom. You are known to us amid our dreams and our deliberations. Sleeping or waking, we cannot hide from your presence. You are around us and within us. You direct us and watch over us. We give you thanks for your grace. Soften those who resist your truth. Surprise them with the message of new life that awaits their response. turn them from making themselves their only source of value, and show them how your mercy can transform their world. Surround and nourish the young in faith, the newly baptized, whose commitment has not yet been tested. Keep them from trials beyond their capacity to endure. Help them take risks that will strengthen their resolve to stand firm in Jesus Christ. Build up their confidence through the gift of your Holy Spirit. Enable us in the family of faith to be a source of assurance and support to them. Startle those who have grown complacent, whose commitment to Christ has become a leisure time activity. Intrude in our lives with the transforming revelation of your judgment, and astonish us with a sense of your awesome power. Keep us from seeking comforts above discipleship, and make of us faithful witnesses to your eternal and incarnate word. We pray today especially for Ron and Patsy, the family of Jerry Bright. We pray for Savannah, Jesse, Joan, Dennis, Connie, Cindy, Bev, Mary Ann, Art and Laverne, Joan and Ellis, Linda and John, as well as for members of our church family, especially today for Liz and Douglas. All of these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. In Matthew, we read, "Freely you have received, freely give." So let us use this time of offering to think about the ways in which we might give of ourselves and our resources to others.
Thank you.
invite you to be seated, and after the postlude is done, we'll get started with the meeting.